Okay, could I encourage members who are leaving the chamber to do so as quickly and as quietly as possible? The final item of business is a members' business debate on motion 7598 in the name of Kenneth Gibson on bringing back the Eurasian Lynx to Scotland. The debate will be concluded without any questions being put. I'd invite members wishing to participate to press the request to speak buttons as soon as possible, and I call on Kenneth Gibson to open the debate for around 7 minutes, Mr. Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I also thank colleagues who signed my motion to make this debate possible and those who will contribute to it. Today we live in a country that is amongst the most nature-depleted in the world. The Biodiversity Intactness Index, which estimates the percentage of natural biodiversity remaining across the world, found that the UK is in the lowest 10% of nations globally for biodiversity and bottom among the G7. World biodiversity is declining faster than at any time in human history. In recent years, we've seen some notable improvements, both nationally and globally, at least. Across Europe, increased awareness, hunting bans and habitat restoration have thankfully resulted in a gradual return of many native species. In Spain, the Iberian lynx has gone from the world's most endangered feline to the greatest triumph in cat conservation anywhere in just 20 years, with numbers rising from under 100 to over 1,100. Spain has invested to save the lynx, which it calls the Iberian jewel, and has even built wildlife underpasses so lynx territories are linked and the cats less likely to be struck by cars. The animal is popular, even with farmers and landowners who now realise that Iberian lynx don't prey on lambs or domestic animals, but displaced foxes, which do. Indeed, many landowners have launched tourism ventures that offer visitors a chance to see these beautiful animals in the wild. Here, the reintroduction of beavers, ospreys and sea eagles, and action to save wild cats and otters, coupled with new measures to tackle wildlife crime, are all very positive measures, which shows a commitment to conservation. However, any debate around biodiversity cannot ignore the fact that the UK is one of the only countries in Europe with no apex predators, casting doubt on our appetite to play a role in addressing the recovery of degraded ecosystems. We cannot expect Africa, Asia and Latin America to save rare species without saving and restoring our own. The EU's biodiversity strategy for 2030 is a comprehensive, ambitious and long-term plan to protect nature and reverse ecosystem degradation. The strategy aims to put Europe's biodiversity on a path to recovery by 2030 and seeks binding restoration targets for specific habitats and species, protecting up to 30% of our land and seas, and we should be able to do at least as well. Eurasian lynx are part of the solution and have already been successfully reintroduced in Austria, France, Germany and Switzerland, all more densely populated than Scotland. And research has confirmed that our highlands has enough habitat and suitable prey to support a population of around 400 lynx. Eurasian lynx are one of four lynx species found around the world. Originally native to Scotland, the last of them were exterminated in the southern uplands in 1760. They are crepuscular and shy, medium-sized wildcats inhabiting dense woodland and mountain slopes far from human settlements. The demise of the lynx was caused by human activity, including hunting, the collapse of wild deer populations and widespread loss of woodland. Scotland, having undergone partial reforestation over the last century, coupled with a massive growth in deer populations, means we now have both ample habitat and prey for lynx to thrive. Reintroducing European lynx is not only morally right, it would contribute to nutrient recycling, carcass provision for other species, as well as vegetation and tree regeneration. Of course, a lynx reintroduction programme must meet strict environmental and policy tests laid down by Nature Scot, the Government Conservation Agency, and the International Union for the Conservation of Nature. The agency's rules require licence applicants to prove a reintroduced species can survive naturally, avoiding conflicts with local landowners such as sheep or chicken farmers by causing unacceptable harm to people's well-being, livelihoods and recreational activities. The Lynx to Scotland partners, Trees for Life, Lifescape and Scotland, The Big Picture, support a five-year trial reintroduction of lynx, recognising that this relies on navigating complex social, cultural and possibly political obstacles. Of course, any reintroduction must be preceded by careful discussions between all stakeholders, including gamekeepers, foresters, farmers, conservationists, landowners, tourism businesses and rural communities. During 2023, the Lynx Focus Group will explore the barriers to lynx reintroduction, aiming to build trust between stakeholders and address areas of disagreement over science and local knowledge. We face a climate emergency and must be bold to rectify the damage our unsustainably high carbon emissions have done since the Industrial Revolution. The Scottish Government's draft climate change plan proposed ambitious targets for future woodland expansion to cover 20% of Scotland by 2032. Forestry and Land Scotland plant between 15 and 24 million trees each year, combining replanting sites where timber is harvested, woodland created and dead trees replaced following replanting. Unfortunately, a major hindrance is that most young trees are vulnerable to deer for up to 5 years. Forestry and Land Scotland survey specifically for deer damage on productive crops. Last year, the rolling three-year average of trees damaged by deer, even with environmentally harmful plastic covers, damaged by deer was 20%, up from 15% in 2017. The Eurasian lynx is a big game hunter that preys predominantly on medium-sized woodland deer such as roan sitka and the calves of red deer. As a highly efficient predator of deer, its reintroduction will help reduce or, at the very least, redistribute deer populations and ease the pressure on our woodlands. Understanding these hunting patterns is also key to addressing the concerns held by some farmers and gamekeepers about possible lynx attacks on sheep. According to Dr. David Hetherington, a leading expert on Eurasian lynx who works as a Nature Networks manager at the Cairngorms National Park Authority, the presence of four or more deer per square kilometre of forest usually means little scope for sheep predation. Scotland's density currently sits at over 10 deer per square kilometre. And in countries where sheep graze and flocks in open pasture alongside woodland, Dr. Hetherington described sheep predation as small-scale with one or two local attacks. I encourage colleagues to attend Tuesday evening's parliamentary reception about lynx reintroduction, sponsored by Ariane Burgess. We can talk directly to Dr. Hetherington about what it would mean to live alongside lynx in Scotland. Public support is key. The latest research led by Charities Scotland, the Big Picture, Trees for Life and Vincent Wildlife Trust spent a year consulting a range of different stakeholders and local communities in the Cairngorms National Park and Argyll. There was sufficient appetite to develop a more comprehensive understanding of the potential for lynx reintroduction to warrant further exploration. Discussion should also focus on important practicalities, such as compensation schemes in case of livestock predation. In Switzerland, where there are 250 lynx and fewer deer, predation of sheep has remained under 50 animals per year across the whole country since 2006, fluctuating slightly in response to changes in deer population. Problem lynx, meaning those taking 15 or more sheep in a year, can legally be shot under licence, but this hasn't happened in 20 years. To put that in perspective, only a fortnight ago, a dog killed 16 lambs in Fife. Presiding officer, like many colleagues, I greatly enjoyed watching the landmark David Attenborough series on the BBC Wild Isles. It highlighted the important work undertaken to halt the alarming decline in nature, wildlife and habitats across the British Isles. Sir David said, and I quote, "We all need to urgently repair our relationship with the natural world. We now have a few short years during which we can still make a choice." Conservationists have for many decades worked hard to save our dwindling wildlife. Now is the time to move beyond just saving existing species by taking a more proactive approach in reintroducing native species driven to extinction by human activity. Lynx will prosper in Scotland. There's plenty of food and habitat. Where they will is ultimately down to societal choices, our willingness to share space with other species. Reintroducing native species like the Eurasian lynx is not a panacea when it comes to biodiversity loss, but it can be a positive measure to boost the health of our natural world, help tackling climate change and biodiversity loss in the process.
Thank you very much, Mr Gibson. We move to the open debate. I call Edward Mountain to be followed by Ariane Burgess. Around 4 minutes, Mr Mountain.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And before I start, I'd like to remind the Chamber of my register of interest that I've been a farmer for over 40 years, and I've been involved in managing the countryside for a period of that time. I don't think Mr Gibson's going to be surprised when I say to him that I am not one of those people who would like to see lynx reintroduced to the Cairngorms. It has been 500 years away from this country, and bringing it back now is just not the time. And as far as I can see, as an MSP representing the Cairngorms, there is no appetite for its reintroduction, except for some conservation organisations who are interested in single species and the introduction and reforestation of the Highlands. What we ought to be doing, rather than talking about introducing new species, is managing the species that we are in danger of losing. Now, in the Cairngorms, one of those species is the capercaillie. It is vitally important. We have pumped millions of pounds into protecting the capercaillie. The RSPB have had Abernethy Reserve for a considerably long period of time and have done nothing to reverse it. Therefore, Yes, I'll come to you, Mr. Gibson, just in a minute, if I may. Therefore, the cap a cayley is something we should be spending more time on doing. And I fear that lynx will really attack this ground nesting bird in the same way that other predators that have come in recently, such as the pine marten, has done. Presiding officer, I'll give way to Mr. Gibson.
Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you very much to Edward Mountain for taking intervention. Research has actually shown that the lynx actually keeps fox numbers down, who are more likely to kill the capper cayley. And also, you talk about not having reintroducing species. Does that mean you don't think we should have reintroduced the beaver, the sea eagle, or, for example, the osprey back in 1971?
I'll come to a lot of those speeches, presiding officer, if I may. But also, along with the capercaillie, the other important ground nesting birds that we see around the Cairngorms. And this doesn't just include curlews and birds that nest on grassland outside the woodland edges, but also shanks and pipers, which would nest in areas of afforestation, exactly where they'll be found by the lynx. Now, we have an appalling track record when it comes to the reintroduction of species. And I'm going to talk about beavers because you mentioned it, Mr. Gibson. First of all, we shouldn't forget that beavers were illegally reintroduced into this country, into Tayside, and have spread out since. In fact, I was on the committee when I heard Rosanna Cunningham explaining that if we were allowed them to go further, they would not be spread by humans beyond that. They would have to spread out naturally, and that lethal control would still be part of the positive management action that needs to be undertaken in relation to this species. We've now got a minister that's changed all of that, and we're allowing beavers, and we're talking about relocating beavers into areas where they've never been before. Glen Affric, for example. Now, I can proudly hold up my hand and say that I've been managed land up around Glen Affric and personally authorised the culling of about 30,000 deer to allow the trees to grow up in Glen Affric. And now we're going to bring in an animal that's going to eat them and knock them all down? Doesn't seem to make much sense to me. And Mr. Gibson mentioned seagulls. Well, we brought seagulls back. And they're great because we can actually see them. We very rarely see beavers, but we can see sea eagles. But they come with problems. They do take lambs. They do take sheep. And I have farmers on Skye contacting me regularly about the need to controlling seagulls and preventing them taking their hefted flocks, the lambs from their hefted flocks, which will prevent them from carrying out future activities. In fact, we're paying farmers. We're paying farmers quite a lot of money when it comes to loss of lambs. And the other issue, just on other species which we're trying to protect, I just want to mention the wildcat. You mentioned the wildcat. It's a personal issue for me to see wildcats reintroduced. I've taken a huge amount of time going to the Royal Zoological Society for Scotland to make sure that we're getting wildcats back. Now, they're going to be in direct competition with lynx, and lynx are not going to do them any favours. So when it comes to lynxes, I believe that when it comes to the Highlands, what we're seeing is central belt activity saying, it's fine, let's put lynx up into the Highlands. Well, in the Highlands, farmers are despairing at the suggestion that lynx are going to come in there. Conservation bodies for important species like capercaillie, wildcats, are despairing when it comes to reintroducing the lynxes because the very species that they're trying to protect will become the prey. And what I would also say when it comes to tourism, there's always lots of noise made about how beavers are going to increase tourism. I want to know how many tourists have actually seen a beaver. And if lynxes would come back, I want to know how many tourists would actually see a lynx. I doubt it very much that there would be many. Now, it was the previous Minister for Agriculture who said when it came to the reintroduction of lynxes, over my dead body, is what he said at a conference. Well, I hope that we don't see Fergus's Ewing dead body as lynxes are railroaded through into the Highlands. But I make this message as my final point, presiding officer. I just say, keep your lynx ideas and your lynx effects to yourself. We don't want them in the Highlands. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mountain. And I call Ariane Burgess to be followed by Christine Graham. Around 4 minutes, Ms. Burgess.
Thanks, presiding officer. I'm going to get the microphone in place here. I want to thank Kenny Gibson for securing this debate, which I see as a contribution to our national conversation about whether we're ready for the reintroduction of Eurasian lynx. In the face of the nature and climate emergencies, we need all the help we can get from nature. Lynx can help us in our efforts to restore nature, especially our forests, which in turn will help us bring down the rising temperatures of our climate. But any reintroduction must be done with people involved in land management understanding why bringing back the Lynx to Scotland is necessary. And I want to commend Trees for Life, Lifescapes and Scotland the Big Picture for their proactive work on this in Argyll and the Cairngorms National Park. Under a range of international agreements, countries around the world signed up to do the work of reintroducing species that were once present. And as Kenny has said, we have evidence that Lynx once made Scotland their home. Coupled with these commitments, we now have biodiversity obligations to protect and restore 30% of Scotland's nature and land, nature on land and at sea by 2030. And that's just a little over 6 years away. We understand now that nature plays a central role in how we can reduce and stabilise rising temperatures in our climate, supporting land managers to work together in landscape scale. Nature restoration will be key. But we have so much work to do, and some of it will have to be done by allowing nature to get on with it. And this means we need to create the conditions for natural regeneration, and the Lynx can play a key role in creating these conditions. Reforesting Scotland is essential. Barren mountains and moors are not natural, and in most cases, they are a result of overgrazing by deer. We have, as we heard already, four types of deer in Scotland, including two that are native, the smaller roe deer and red deer. And we currently have an average of 20 deer per square kilometre, when actually our land has a carrying capacity for about two per square kilometre. Lynx would be a natural predator for the smaller roe deer. But it's not just actually reducing deer numbers that the lynx can help with. In nature, predators help to shape the landscape by simply being present. Deer won't go to places where they know lynx are present. And in this way, the grazing pressure is reduced and natural regeneration can take place. There's a world-class example of this when wolves were reintroduced to Yellowstone National Park in the United States, and their presence alone stopped the deer from grazing specific areas of the park, which allowed forests to regenerate. And now in Scotland, we have the right conditions for introducing lynx, enough of the right habitat and enough food. I am aware, as Edward Mountain has said, and I'm not going to take an intervention, I am aware that people who manage our land are concerned about reintroduction of lynx. And I think that we need to bring them into this conversation. As Scotland's leading expert, as we know, Dr. David Hetherington has said, when people hear about lynx, they tend to conflate them with wolves and describe wolf behaviour. But we must get curious about the lynx and want to understand it. Lynx, while being a top predator, are different from wolves. They live in forests where they are safe under cover, and that's where they prefer to hunt. They are elusive and tend to stay away from humans. In the Jura Mountains in Switzerland, which we've already heard about, lynx were reintroduced in the 1970s and have rarely caused problems for land managers and farmers. Regulations are in place, which is what we could do, that if a lynx becomes a problem, and by that this means killing over 15 sheep in a year, a license can be applied for to shoot that lynx. They haven't had to authorise a license since 2003. In closing, Presiding Officer, I invite everyone participating in this debate and everyone in this Parliament to continue being curious about how the lynx can help us by joining me next Tuesday evening in the Holyrood Room, where we can explore, is Scotland ready for lynx? And hear from Dr. David Hetherington. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Burgess. And I call Christine Graham, around 4 minutes, Ms. Graham.
I thought when you mentioned reintroducing wolves that Edward's going to fall off his chair. Deputy Presiding Officer, first of all, I congratulate the member in securing this intriguing debate. Let me add that this does not mean, Edward Mountain, that the reintroduction of the lynx is imminent, but it opens up the debate for, I hope, informed and tolerant discussion. I'll reference the detailed research by Lynx for Scotland, which sought to assess the social feasibility of potential lynx reintroduction to Scotland through consultation with stakeholders and communities in two focal areas, Cairngorms National Park and Argyll. I understand this represents the first effort to assess social feasibility and is of central importance for the proposed reintroduction of a large carnivore that has been absent from Britain for a period of time equivalent to multiple human generations. Now some graphic but relevant information, Deputy Presiding Officer. The lynx is, of course, a pure carnivore. Depending on region and availability of prey, it hunts cloven-hoofed animals such as roe deer, as well as young red deer, and small mammals such as hares and rabbits, and in rare instances, smaller predators such as foxes are also on the lynx menu. It hunts mainly in the evening when its prey is also active, and its territory is heavily wooded and afforested areas. When hunting, the lynx is aided by its excellent sensory organs. It can see six times better in the dark than a human and is able to spot a rabbit from a distance of 300 metres. With its finely tuned ears, it can also hear the slightest rustle. It's a stalk and ambush hunter which catches its prey, just like a cat does. I understand if a surprise attack fails, however, the prey is not pursued. It seizes its prey with its front claws and kills it with a bite to the throat. If it has killed a deer and is not disturbed, the lynx will return to its prey in several nights until it has completely consumed it. A lynx needs to kill about one deer a week, which equates to around 60 animals a year. So it could be, and I just say could, be providing a natural means of keeping deer numbers down, predate on foxes, which in turn predate on ground-nesting birds. Now, having been driven to extinction in parts of Europe since the beginning of the 19th century, yes, certainly.
Edward Mountain.
Presiding Officer, thank you. And I thank the member for giving way. I totally appreciate that there may be some other predators killed, which could be foxes, could be wildcats, but it's also going to kill ground-nesting birds. The very ground-nesting birds in the Cairngorms that we are red-listing as a endangered species of the capercaillie. Does the member accept that capercaillie would be put under increased threat by the lynx?
Christine Graham.
From my information, from many good gamekeepers in my part of the south of Scotland, it's foxes they're concerned about that are predating on ground-nesting birds. Foxes are the problem snipping out of the woods. But hold your peace, because you're going to be happy with my conclusion, I hope. But of course, there were diverse views, as expected, on the benefits and disbenefits of reintroduction, and that's quite rightly the case. Indeed, there was a proposal for the trial reintroduction of lynx to Kildare Forest by the Lynx UK Trust in 2018, which was rejected by the then Secretary of State for Environment, Food and Rural Affairs for, among other reasons, insufficient engagement with key stakeholders and communities. So, the overall objectives of the Lynx to Scotland study was to provide an evidence base to inform the discourse among stakeholders about the feasibility of reintroduction, being clear about the range of views of stakeholders and to gain a clearer understanding of public belief and perceptions around reintroducing the animal. 430 verbatim statements were initially selected from interview transcripts refined to a set of 52 statements and then considered. Community groups were also invited to engage. It was reinforced that roe deer had become hugely problematic over recent decades and difficult to hunt under woodland cover. It was thought that in an ideal world, lynx would have a regulatory impact on smaller carnivores that are negatively impacting protected species, such as, I've already said, the capercaillie. And it was questioned what role lynx might play in contributing to nutrient recycling in woodland. However, it was also expressed that red deer are commercially very valuable to the Highland economy and lynx might be detrimental to this. A potential consequence of lynx reducing red deer abundance was thought to be loss of grazed heath with knock-on impacts on protected species and perhaps an increased risk of wildfire on the peatlands. Questions were also asked about the growth dynamics for lynx populations, what limited their numbers in Europe. The main body of discussion, of course, was a discussion concerning the potential impact of lynx on sheep farming in Scotland. And naturally, farmers want to protect their sheep from traumatic, unnecessary death. Now, I hope you're listening, Mr. Mountain, because the recommendations, I've selected three from the study. This is the first. It is not currently appropriate for proponents of lynx reintroduction to submit a licence application for it. At present, there are significant areas of contestation with regards to the feasibility of lynx reintroduction, and if these are not satisfactorily addressed, there is a strong potential for the escalation of existing conflicts. Secondly, a group with cross-sectoral representation should be established to appraise the findings of this study. The process should seek to integrate local and scientific knowledge in appraising and addressing these areas, and the output from this group should inform the processes. And thirdly, this is not all of them, a comprehensive risk assessment for protected species and rural industries is required in order to address divergent perceptions over the potential impacts, both positive and negative, of Lynx reintroduction. So I will conclude by saying to Mr. Mowen, I do understand his concerns, that he look at this considered report and see that it's not coming out with a proposal that is reintroduced now and then, but that much more detailed research must be done to satisfy all of the stakeholders should and if and when the Eurasian Lynx is reintroduced to Scotland. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms Graham. I know we can rely on you to provide the graphic information, if not to stick to your time limit in a member's debate. With that, I now invite Lorna Slater to respond to the debate, Minister, for around 7 minutes, please.
Thank you so much, Presiding Officer. Well, thank you everyone who's contributed to this debate, and thank you Kenneth Gibson for bringing this debate. It's lovely to hear support for conservation and nature restoration. I was really interested to hear about the data on the Iberian lynx. I didn't know that lynx competed with foxes. This is not an area of a specialty for me, so this is for me a good opportunity to learn about this, so that was very interesting to hear. I thought it was really important that Mr. Gibson highlighted the damage to trees by deer, because that absolutely highlights the importance of deer management to effective conservation and promotion of biodiversity. Mr. Hamilton highlights the risks to capercaillie. Of course, that is an extremely endangered species that we're very concerned about in Scotland right now, so I appreciate his highlighting that species, which we are doing so much to protect because it is such an iconic species here. When we return to beavers, I, of course, do not support illegal introductions of any animals, any animal species, and the illegal introduction of beavers into the Tayside catchment basin has caused innumerable problems, which, of course, has set back the acceptance of beavers a long way through those. However, we now have the Scottish Beaver Strategy, which put together by 50, I think that's the right number, 50 different stakeholders, which is to reintroduce beavers across Scotland to appropriate areas where that stakeholder engagement has been done, because I appreciate that how things were done in Tayside was not the right way and they shouldn't be done like that. Certainly, go ahead.
Edward Mountain.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Just when it comes to all of managing species, I just want to be clear from the Minister's point of view, do you believe that lethal control should be part of a management option?
Through the chair, please, Mr. Mountain. Minister.
Sorry, do I believe that I didn't catch that part?
Presiding Officer, I was asking if the Minister believed that lethal control should be part of the management options when species are introduced.
Minister.
That's a very good question for the member. I mean, at the moment, lethal control is still used overwhelmingly for beavers. I think we've only managed to relocate a handful of beavers in Scotland. So lethal control is still being used overwhelmingly for beaver management. So that is still our main tool there, which I think is unfortunate, but you know, that's the reality of the situation that we're in. We, of course, want to translocate beavers wherever that is possible to appropriate sites. Under licence. Arianne Burgess, as the regional MSP for Highlands and Islands, of course did contradict Mr. Mountain's claim somewhat that the Highlands don't want this. So thank you, Arianne, for providing an alternative view there. And Christine Graham, it was very welcome, her contribution about opening the debate and her enthusiasm for effective community engagement and full engagement with all stakeholders. I think it is interesting to note, as Ms. Graham said, about the opening up, the starting of a debate. I was recently at one of the events here in Parliament with many environmental stakeholders and spoke to a gentleman who had been wanting to reintroduce beavers into the UK for 25 years. So when the first introductions were done in Scotland, I believe it was in 2009, and now, of course, we've got this beaver strategy for introducing beavers all over Scotland. For him, that was a sort of epiphany, a lifetime's work coming to fruition, that children in Scotland will now grow up alongside beavers in their natural environment, which I think is wonderful and a significant achievement for us. The Scottish Government fully recognises that appropriate reintroductions of native species can be beneficial to ecosystems and restoring biodiversity. And these include successful reintroduction of sea eagle, beaver, and red kite. There are benefits that lynx can bring, such as their ability to reduce deer numbers naturally, as well as the creation of new opportunities for wildlife tourism. Oh, I wanted to answer Mr. Mountain's point on, I have seen beavers in the wild, but only in Canada. The ones here I have not yet seen because there simply aren't enough of them, but I'm looking forward to when there are more. At dawn and sunset, you can also see them. The one I saw in Canada was actually in broad daylight, but there you go. The reintroduction of an apex predator such as the lynx can profoundly change the ecology of an area, as alluded to by Ms. Burgess, in various ways, and a key consideration in understanding how reintroduced lynx might affect the current ecological balance centres around their interactions with other carnivores. This would be most notable with the Scottish wildcat, red fox, badger and pine marten, as all of these species have existed in Scotland in the absence of a top predator like a lynx for hundreds of years. Alongside the potential benefits, we also have to consider the negative effect lynx may have. For example, farmers will quite understandably be concerned about the impacts they may have on livestock and on sheep in particular. While roe deer would be expected to make up the vast majority of a lynx's diet in Scotland, other species may be taken. These are likely to include rarer and iconic species such as capercaillie, red squirrel and the Scottish wildcat. There may also be risks to the critically endangered Scottish wildcat, either through interference or killing rather than consumption. We have always been clear that any reintroduction of a species such as lynx could only take place following full consultation that ensured the views of those who are most likely to be most effective are properly taken into account. Anyone who wants to release any new species, such as the lynx, would require a licence from Nature Scot, who would assess any such application in line with the Scottish Code for Conservation Translocations. They would also consult the National Species Reintroduction Forum, which has an advisory role with Scottish Government and other stakeholders prior to reaching any licensing decision. The Lynx to Scotland report noted that there are major barriers that would need to be satisfactorily addressed before any such reintroduction could be taken forward. The report demonstrated that reintroduction projects are often complex and require careful consideration and planning to ensure national and international best practice guidelines are met. Any proposed application would also require a substantial amount of work to be undertaken to fill the current knowledge gaps, as Ms. Graham alluded to. The Scottish Government remains open to constructive and informative conversations and debates, such as this one this evening, which can help us all understand more about the potential impacts of lynx reintroductions in Scotland. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much indeed. Minister, that concludes the debate, and I close this meeting of Parliament.